secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God
in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer, for you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who in the Paschal mystery established the new covenant of reconciliation, grant that all who have been reborn into the fellowship of Christ's body may show forth in their lives what they profess by their faith. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
Reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of power, wonders, and signs that God did through him among you. As you yourselves know, this man handed over to you according to the definite plan and the foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of those outside the law. But God raised him up, having freed him from death, because it was impossible for him to be held in his power. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand, so that I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my tongue rejoices. Moreover, my flesh will live in hope, for you will not abandon my soul to Hades, or let your Holy One experience corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence, fellow Israelites. I may say to you confidently that our ancestor David, that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Since he was a prophet, he knew that God had sworn an oath to him that he would put one of his descendants on his throne. Foreseeing this, David spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, saying, he was not abandoned to Hades, nor his flesh experienced corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that we are all of us are witnesses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Upon those who are noble
portion and my cup. It is you who uphold and lost.
I come down to raise and close a pleasant land. Indeed, I have a goodly heritage.
I will bless the Lord who gives me counsel. My heart teaches me, night after night.
I have said the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand, I shall not fall.
My heart, therefore, is glad and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope.
For you will not abandon me to the grave, nor let the Holy One see the pit.
You will show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore.
A reading from the first letter of Peter. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold, that, though perishable, is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy. For you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Lord Christ, be on my lips and in our hearts, that the word spoken and the word heard may be in truth your word. Amen.
Amen.
John's Gospel tells us that the doors were locked for fear of the Jews. Picture it. The evening on that first Easter, Jesus has risen from the dead and appears to Mary Magdalene, the apostle to the apostles, and given her the instruction to tell the other disciples about the tragedy. Death has been conquered. Hell has been terror. And here are 10 of the 11 disciples, locking themselves in a room out of fear. Did they not hear Mary's report? Didn't they know they had reason to rejoice? Maybe they just didn't believe her. After all, it sounded incredible. How could something so amazing actually happen? And it's not like they had proof, just Mary's word to go on. So they locked themselves in a room with their fear. But a locked door has apparently a fearful heart. Is not something to dissuade Jesus. Jesus showed up. Jesus appears to his frightened disciples. Walking in their midst like a locked door was no obstacle. And he declared peace to them. Then he gives them what they seemingly require, proof of who he is and proof that he really is alive. He shows them his wounds, his hands, his feet, and his side. Jesus is vulnerable with them. And then they rejoice. We then hear about Thomas, who actually wasn't with them at the time. What he was doing, we don't know. Maybe he just stepped out for a walk, for a breath of fresh air. Maybe he was doing charitable works. Whatever he was up to, he missed Jesus' appearance. Then when he hears the reports about Jesus, he voices the very same doubts and disbelief that the other disciples manifested earlier. He says he won't believe unless he gets to see the wounds and place his fingers and his hands inside them. Because of this response, some have labeled Thomas a skeptic. They liken him to the person who wants verifiable proof of the miraculous in order to believe. Or we think of Thomas as having weak faith, not exactly being the exemplary disciple. I beg to differ. Thomas is called the twin. Now there are many explanations for what that means exactly, but one that I rather like, whether it's the only meaning or not, is a theological interpretation, which says that Thomas is the twin because he is so like us. He is our twin. We are just like he doubts as we doubt. He is afraid just as we are afraid. He is someone we can relate to. So Thomas is not especially doubtful or especially fearful. In fact, he is as doubtful and fearful as his fellow disciples, who just 1 week prior, the night of Easter, let me remind you, locked themselves in the room out of fear. They did not believe Mary Magdalene and the other woman. The leg up they have on Thomas is because they were at the right place at the right time. And missing out on this appearance of Jesus sparks something in Thomas. It leads him to voice a desire that perhaps he was not even aware of before. He tells the other disciples that he wants to touch Jesus. That he wants to see the wounds and place his fingers and his hands in them. He wants a sensory experience of the Messiah. His fear and doubt, a natural part of anyone's spiritual journey, lead him to seek a new way of knowing Jesus. So a week passes by after that first Easter, and the disciples again gather together. This time, Thomas is with them. And although the doors aren't locked, we are told that although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them. The doubt yet remaining is not enough to dissuade Jesus. He shows up anyway. He appears again, this time solely for one person's benefit. And he lets Thomas not only see him, but touch him, giving him that sensory experience that he asked for, and urging him to believe. The matter of belief in Jesus is not as simple as we might think. This gospel reading illustrates for us how common it is for doubt to be part of the faith journey. After all, these were Jesus' disciples who were with him for 3 years. If they have doubts, how much more will we also have doubts? But even in the midst of their doubts, Jesus appears. Our doubts are not enough to keep Jesus from us. Jesus showed up for his disciples, and he will show up. And our doubts can actually serve to strengthen our faith by giving us new information about our desires and longings. It may well have been Thomas's doubt that spurred him on to ask for the ability to touch Jesus' wounds. So his doubt led to new spiritual knowledge for him. And perhaps it arose out of his sensory needs. There are many ways to engage with our spirituality, and the sense of touch is one of these ways. Like Thomas, we can learn from our doubts. Perhaps they are leading us to engage with our spirituality in a new way. In honor of Thomas, let's consider today the different ways we can experience Jesus. The Episcopal Church has some of these opportunities built in. We recently did a whole lot of movement and had a whole lot of sensory experiences in worship. During Holy Week, we processed with palms. And if you were sitting near me, you may have gotten whacked by a palm by Willow. We knelt and washed feet or had our feet washed on Maundy Thursday. We had the opportunity to venerate the cross on Good Friday. And at the vigil, we saw and heard the splashing of water at the baptisms. But these sensory opportunities are not confined to Holy Week. They will continue. Periodically, we get splashed with the water of the aspersions. Every week, we can sit, stand, kneel. We walk toward the front of the church for a blessing or to receive the host, which we feel with our hands and taste with our tongues. We can smell the wine, and if we choose to intake, we taste it as well. During the passing of the peace, we shake hands or hug if we're up for it, or if not, we have the visual image of waving, smiling, and a peace sign. We have many beautiful things to look at in this sanctuary. The hangings, the colors on the vestments, the images of St. Luke, the cross. We can watch the flames on the altar candles. We can listen to voices, to instruments, and sing. As someone who lives in my head a lot, I welcome the opportunity to be reminded of these ways to involve my senses and thus my whole self in worship. There's evidence from trauma research that involving our bodies is very important for the processing of emotions. So in addition to learning something new about God, I could potentially also learn something new about myself. I am grateful today for our twin among the disciples, Thomas, and for the example he shows us of how our doubts can lead to new knowledge of ourselves and new experiences of Jesus. He engaged his senses and was able to know Jesus through the sense of touch. We can follow his lead and pay attention to our doubts, as well as engaging with our faith through our senses. As we do so, we will be able to bring our whole selves to God.
The only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary, and was made man. Sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'd like to direct your attention to our bulletin and any announcements that you will find there. I don't have anything else particular to say. Steve, you have nothing?
Thank you, Mother Alec. I've been kind of looking around the room, the church here this morning, to see if there's anyone here old enough to remember a show back in the early 1970s called Rowan and Martin's Laugh-In. And one of the staples of that show every week was something called the Flying Fickle Finger of Fate Award, which was given every week to a deserving entity like the U.S. Congress. The finger is alive and well because St. Luke's needs some volunteers. Two things in particular. There are members of our congregation who need rides to the service on Sunday mornings. And we're trying to develop a list of people who are willing to give rides to these individuals. And there is a sign-up sheet in the back room for coffee hour if you'd like to volunteer for that. In addition, there's some work that we need to do on the outside of the building of the parish hall during the spring and summer. The window frames are in dire need of being sanded to some degree, primed and repainted. They're in the wood's in good shape, so we won't have to do much in the way of that, but we are going to need a team of volunteers to help out with that. We already have some, so if you or a member of your family or you know of someone else who isn't here that maybe you can volunteer them in their absence, always the best way to do things, please do so. We all would appreciate it. One last thing, the affiliation process with Grace St. Paul over in Hamilton is still ongoing. We are not yet affiliated. Father Mike is not the priest in charge. He is with us on a supply basis. And until there is an agreement reached and a document that's signed and put into place, we will continue with supply until that happens. So I ask for your patience. Vestry is still working on it. And sooner enough, we will have some resolution on that. But again, we look for your help in volunteering and spruce up things around here. And a glorious Sunday to everyone. Thank you.
Any other announcements from the congregation? Yes, all right.
The diocese runs in our hearings. It's a course, fairly old course. It's 20 hours. Mother Ali has taken it. Felicia, I think, who took it. And Deacon Vasquez has taken it. It's a virtual course. It starts this Friday. Friday nights, 4 weeks, from 7 to 9, virtually on Zoom. And the rest of it is on your own time to do the homework, the reading, if you choose. If you don't choose, you won't get a certificate. But it's very, very important. And in between, there are lectures by some of us in the diocese on various aspects of anti-racism and justice work. We're asking for people to sign up. If you can't afford it, some of the the diocese will pay for it. Again, it starts this Friday, the 21st, 7 p.m., and you can register off the diocese webpage. Thank you.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you. We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is truly right to glorify you, Father, and to give you thanks. You alone are God, living and true, dwelling in light and accessible from before time and forever. Fountain of light and source of all goodness, you made all things and filled them with your blessing. You created them to rejoice in the splendor of your radiance. Countless throngs of angels stand before you to serve you night and day, and beholding the glory of your presence, they offer you unceasing praise. Joining with them and giving voice to every creature under heaven, we acclaim you and glorify your name as we sing. Remember all your people and those who seek your truth. Remember those in need of your healing grace and loving presence, especially Joyce, Patsy, Carol, Janine, Patricia, Vibart, Barbara, Bruce, Carol, Barbara, Herb, Mildred, Valerie, Robert, Tom, Hibbert, Sean, Taylor, Ralph, Yvonne, Pat, Bobby, Jacob, Bella, Ben and Barbara, Anna, Keoli, Nancy, Audrey, John, Stuart and his family, Audrey, Lorraine and their family, and Theo. Remember all who have died in the peace of Christ, especially Louise O'Granger, and those whose faith is known to you alone. Bring them into the place of eternal joy and light. And grant that we may find our inheritance with the Blessed Virgin Mary, with patriarchs and matriarchs, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, with St. Paul, St. Luke, and all the saints who have found favor with you in ages past. We praise you in union with them, and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty God and Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior, precious Father, we are bold to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Hallelujah. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
saints and of the living God. We thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory.